Today we're going to talk about internal waves, something a little bit different. This is similar kind of waves to what we started with. So it's gravity waves. The restoring force in the vertical is gravity and buoyancy. But the difference is that they're not surface waves. They're waves which are in the interior of the fluid at a certain depth. Okay? So we'll start by looking at a few examples of internal waves. Then we'll talk about the kind of oscillations that give rise to internal waves, buoyancy oscillations. And we'll derive the dispersion relation, as usual, for these kind of waves. And then at the end, we'll start looking at different types of things that can trigger these waves. One of the things that can trigger internal waves is the tides. So the internal waves which are triggered by tides are called internal tides. And then lee waves, so the presence of topography at the bottom of the ocean or mountains in the atmosphere, that can also trigger internal waves. All right, so let's just have a look at the structure of an internal wave. So we have here is the surface of the fluid, right? And we're talking about a wave which is here in the middle. So in this example, we've got two different densities. So you could do this in a fish tank if you had water and oil, for example. And you could set up some waves in between the two fluids, and you'd see how they propagate. They propagate in the same way as a surface wave. And so if the wave is propagating in that direction, then there'll be a fluid trajectory in a clockwise direction underneath the crest of the wave here, and that diminishes with depth, just like before. The thing that's different is some of the parameters are different, so in fact you get a different phase speed than you would if it was a surface wave. Instead of gravity, you have what we call reduced gravity. We'll come to that. And of course you also have a fluid on top, which is playing an important role. The circulation in the fluid above is going in the opposite direction. It's anti-clockwise above. Yeah. Okay, clockwise here, anti-clockwise here. And of course, if you have convergence ahead of the wave in the lower fluid, which is what we had before, right? That means that the thickness of the lower fluid is going to get bigger. This is going to go up. You have divergence here, this is going to go down. So the wave will propagate that way. Okay? You have to have the opposite in the fluid above. So if the wave is propagating that way, this interface is moving upwards. So there's more fluid arriving here. This is convergent. There's fluid which has to depart from this position in this fluid, so this is divergent. Right? So where you have convergence here, you have divergence here. And where you have divergence here, you have convergence here. Right? So let's have a look at a few examples of internal waves. So here's an example in the ocean. So this is off the coast of Somalia. In fact, north is in that direction. And this is the very tip of the Horn of Africa. And the current comes through here, and variations in the current will produce these ripples on the surface. So this, obviously an aerial photo, some sort of aerial photo, and you can see these ripples on the surface. They're kind of an indicator of internal waves at a greater depth. So this fluid is stratified at a greater depth, and there's an internal wave which, because that interface is going up and down internally, that will create pressure differences at the surface, which will create a slight signature of that at the surface. Right? So that's why it's visible at the surface. Bay of Biscay, or Gulf de Gascogne, it's a place where there's a very rapid change in depth. So here there's a very strong shelf break. You have a continental shelf, and then you have plunges down to the deep ocean very quickly here. And it's a bit of a rough area, because that shelf break can trigger internal waves which propagate vertically to the surface, and they create disturbed conditions at the surface. Another place where you can trigger internal waves is the Straits of Gibraltar. So you get these internal waves which are generated, and you can see the pattern of them here. So the same deal. These are at mid-depth. The Mediterranean has got relatively fresh water coming in, and there's more evaporation than precipitation in the Mediterranean. So the water gets saltier, it goes to a deeper level, and what comes out is saltier, denser water. And the interface between the two, or the stratification between the two, is a good place for generating internal waves. And so you have internal waves here, which again, you can see the signature on the surface, right? This is the north coast of Australia, right? There's a very beautiful example of internal waves in the atmosphere. Something has happened at the epicenter of this obvious kind of circular arc. There's another one here, and there's another one here. You've got three of them in this picture. And these ripples that you can see in the cloud structure, that's an internal wave in the atmosphere. So in the atmosphere, you have a wave on the stratification of the atmosphere. And you can see it because where there's a cloud, that means air is going up. And where there's clear sky, that's where the air is going down. As air goes up, it expands adiabatically, it cools, and the water vapor in the air condenses into liquid water, and that's a cloud, all right? Where the air is going down, it gets compressed adiabatically, it gets warmer, so if you have liquid water in that parcel of air, it will evaporate and you'll get clear sky, all right? So up, if it's rippling up and down like that, the clouds will show you where the crests and the troughs are in your internal waves.